And I'm very happy that my phone is ringing. I don't know how. And I'm happy about to tell you a little bit more about it. Denmark is quite a small country. And actually, it's a little bit funny because the population is very similar to the Jordanian population. We are the same. We are at the moment 5,584,000 Danes. Amongst those, we have 4,900,000 Danes and 567 immigrants coming from all over the world. Actually, a lot of them from around 16 countries. So at the moment, if we talk about our for instance, religion in Denmark, then we have about 8 to 10% for Muslims. So quite a big percentage. Denmark is, what I would say, a quite calm and relaxed country, in a way that we are quite informal. Normally we are not so that we wish to be particularly somebody or something, and we don't, when we greet each other, for instance, at the road, it's normally just, that's it. And we can do that to the Prime Minister as well, if we want, and she wouldn't get angry with us. So quite informal, quite easy going, and yeah, quite special country. I have drawn our little flag here, it's red and white, and I have written a little bit about our Danish language. It's a Nordic Scandinavian language because Denmark is situated in Scandinavia. That consists of Denmark, Sweden, Norway, and Finland. We all share, apart from the Finnish people, we share more or less the same language, even though it's sometimes it's difficult to understand because the dialects and it's different from parts of the country, but we understand each other fairly well. And the system, I will say, in the four countries are also quite similar way functions. So, okay, that's good. We have got a queen. We've got a monarchy there. She is, it's not that the queen, she's there, and she is actually having some official tasks to do, like helping the government and deciding who and what. But in the same, at the same time, she is not really dealing with politics. It's very funny. She's there as a ceremonial person. And she's just there to, yes, to be there as a head of a state, but at the same time, she's just there as a figure. And in general, we're quite happy about her because she doesn't really bother our system in Denmark that most people are quite happy about. So far, so good. I don't know if you have any questions before that. It's Dronning Margrethe. Margrethe. She is Margrethe the Second, and she has been ruling since 1972, so quite a long time. The whole royal house actually is also getting more and more Danish, which is easygoing and relaxed. As a crown now, he has married with somebody who is normal outside royal families, one from Australia, and I'm sure that this is going to continue to be less and less really Well, we like to have a monarch and we like to have a queen and king, but he will say more. That's okay. More questions? Okay, fine. Let me see if I went through all these different facts. The area of Denmark, quite small again. We are surrounded by lots of water. This is a water nation. Typical water nation. It's a very flat country. The highest point is about 170 meters. And, well, it's green, 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 because it's always raining. It's rain, winter, rain, summer, rain, all the seasons. Which actually, at the moment, is giving us a problem because of global warming, because we have enormous rainfalls. And actually, the system is going to change because we are dealing with a lot of reconstructions of buildings, whatever, in order to contain and maintain all the weight, all the water coming down. We've got our currency, that's a crown, and one crown is about 8 GD.
So it's a bit.
And when you talk about expensive, life in Denmark is very expensive. It is very expensive indeed. I would also say that the Copenhagen, the capital, it's actually, I think it's the sixth most expensive capital in the world at the moment. So, good country to live in, but sometimes we cry when we have to buy things. It's very expensive. Okay. Yeah. Let me talk a little bit more about actually how the government is in Denmark. We have a government normally that consists of several parties. It can work with a minority party as the leading party, but we have a coalition. So they normally have to find other parties to obtain the majority in the government. And we have elections every 4 years, and everything is, what I would say, is super controlled. So something that is very good about Denmark is that we really believe in our election system, we believe in our government, and we believe in what happens in there. That it's really people who can say what they want, and we can go and we can elect people. And I think also Denmark is one of the countries in the world where most people go for elections to vote, because we know that our vote will go where it's going to go. So we know that we will get the person we serve in the right position. So there's a big trust actually for the government. And at the moment, it's a minister called Helen von Schmidt, and she's the prime minister. Actually, there hasn't been any other female prime minister for 4 years back, so she's one of the first. So Denmark is actually at the moment being in the position of having both a queen and a female prime minister.
Which party is she?
She's at the Social Democratic Party. And she's got a coalition together with something what they call Social Liberals and Socialist People's Party. Those parties are very much represented by young people. We have a very young government. So I think actually the average age of all those people leading at the moment is about 35 or something like that. Lots of people below 30. It's quite a dynamic government at the moment. Some people might say the older generation, okay, they're too young to do this, but in general, from people, children, school, children, whatever, they get to know about how to how our system functions. So in that way, I would say they know how to deal with it. Maybe sometimes that's minor problems, but they're good for doing it. Yeah. Any questions on that so far? No. And you're understanding fully?
What the economic kind is it? Neoliberalism, it's mixed, it's a socialist party, it's different, how can it handle it? I think it's a mixed
Yeah, actually that's an excellent question indeed, because when it's represented, it sounds as if we are totally socialist country, but we are not, because we are actually quite, I would say, oriented towards capitalism. As well. So it was like it's semi-socialist, semi-capitalist. It has got both of it because there's large initiatives in order to help people starting up their own businesses, business life in general. It's so that's a they really work hand in hand with those people. At the moment, it might be a little bit more socialist than
social market.
Yeah. It's let's say it's swifting a little bit. Yeah.
I tried to visit it, but I did have I had the student visa, but I was not also allowed to go right. Visit it, right? With student visa, because I wanted, but it was cheap.
Yeah, I don't know. So you couldn't go there, as you say?
No.
Yeah.
They told me it's not work.
Not of the European Union. The market is not.
It is, yeah. It is.
So the Schengen visa can she enter Denmark?
I was not.
In the
Well, I don't know your exact situation there. But we are in EU, and that is that most people working around in these areas, if they have access to one area in Europe, they can go to another one.
I have access to one area, but I wanted to go to
Yeah, I must say, I don't know exactly what your situation is. So it's different to say there.
What is the average age of the people of the
Well, at the moment, actually, it's a little bit higher, I think, because families are small. So we have, at the moment, more people who are above 40 than below. And it's going to be, and actually, when you mentioned this, it's something that is going to create a problem in about 10, 20 years. That is a European phenomenon, I think, because our family, they have been small, people have over maybe one children, yeah, maybe one and a half or something. So it's actually, this is going to create a problem in some years. It's the opposite as Jordan, but we have this huge young generation from family.
Jordan, we have the average 5 children.
Yeah. No,
some people have 13 or 14 children.
Actually, it's a funny thing. Some extremists here, they say actually they're not against freedom in the West or something. And they say, oh, Scandinavian countries have a lot of freedom, we have no problem. Maybe the developing civilization is not about freedom anymore.
Yeah, something I would like to talk about is our welfare system. And that's again how we work, so the same. In Denmark, we have total social equality. So we have equal rights to social security. We have equal rights to health care and education. And both health care and education is totally free. From your child, you can go and study, and you can go and study for many years if you want. And it's paid by the government. And fantastic, isn't it?
Yes.
We all want to go there now.
Yeah.
I was having something afterwards that could be the negative side. When people hear that from abroad, they say, oh, okay, where can I buy a ticket? And then we go there, yeah.
So, how do I get the passport?
Yeah. And, it's that if we're going to take it seriously, this question, then there is some different kind of studies in Denmark where every or most foreign students, they could go and apply for those positions. But they have to go through applications and whatever. And they have to learn our quite complicated Danish language. Even though many of the international studies, they are in English, still they will have to go through a phase. But that's quite a lot of international students in Denmark at the moment. And of course, I'm happy about this situation. The reason why Denmark takes these people in is there's several reasons, of course, but well, we are in lack of young people actually, because we're getting older and older. And the second is that we really believe that if we give this possibility to somebody coming forward, we can also derive some positive result from that. They know our country. We have a multicultural tendency in our country. So we are welcoming this mixture.
If you were born in Denmark, you have the passport.
Yes, we can't. But what we are doing when we have a lot of immigrants is that something in our system is so that if people come to England, they have to do something. If they can't find a work, they have to study. They have to do whatever they are told to do. And they will get some kind of subsidy for doing this. In some way, they will have some kind of education, and hopefully, in the end, there will be an outcome there. The situation is not quite like that at the moment. We have an elderly generation of immigrants, which can't really deal with that. But then we have the second generation of immigrants, and they're fantastic.
They accept that, yeah.
Uh-huh.
They accepted the new generation, they raised as a nation of the.
Yeah.
They have to go through courses, and they have to know the system of them, they have to know the culture, they have to know the language.
So if somebody, someone tries not to do it, they are pushed out there again. If not, actually, you can grab them from the control of them. That's how it is, yeah. Yeah. So.
Are they allowed when they first come to to live with the other Danish people, or they have a certain place. Before we get into the full course.
Oh, well, it's a little bit different. They can only arrive to Canada if they're refugees or accepted as refugees. You're coming as a normal person, coming from whatever country, with just, let's say, a normal life, but once you go there, that's rule for you come to have a job before.
Yeah. And their teachers, they must end the course before they live with the people. They must stay at the campus.
No, it's a degree. But the campus arrive in Denmark first day and then say, okay, I need to have my course in Canada. Only if they are refugees. And they have to be specific cases. Today, it has changed a little bit. So if people wish to go there, they need to have some kind of contract work already. And that's actually a little bit difficult today because we have high unemployment. So even for Danish people, well-educated, they can't be by the job. So it's not just like this. So that has to be a reason why people come there. But anyway, we have this free system, and something you all have got is something called flexicurity. And what is flexicurity? It's actually something that has been developed for many years, and it is so that most employers, they can go to their employees any day and they can say, okay, for another month, and then you have to quit. You haven't performed good enough, and it's very easy for employees to say that to people. If they don't perform well, particularly in our private part of employment, then there's quite a high number of people every year who get fired and end up in conflict. But at the same time, that's the flex that is for the employees. The security is actually that is for the employee. Because when you are out unemployed, immediately you get a subsidy that is about 90% of the lowest income for Danish worker. And that is most people can get unemployed. It's not super, but it's okay. It's okay. It's possible. So you're safe. You're safe, and that's no problem here. But of course, most people they prefer to work because we are there. But it's a system that has been developed in order to help both the working places, so that if people don't perform well enough, well, there's no problem to get them off. For instance, I don't know if you know the situation in Spain. We have a situation, and I still have. About a lot of people not being able to find a job because the older generation who's still in work, they are completely fixed there. You can't stack them, you can't fire them. So we didn't wish to have that situation. We wish to have a flexible system where people, okay, they can be as old as they wish, people work until they're 70 if they wish, even more. As long as they perform well, you can stay. If you don't perform well, you know, but somebody will save you. And that's in a way, a healthy system. In a way, maybe not a health system. When you come to the
What's the minimum wage?
The minimum wage, and now we have to talk about another thing, and that is taxes. But let's say that the minimum wage is about, let me see, how to put it in here, so maybe around 15 GB per hour. There's a system where you, of course, in order to maintain all this freedom here and all this help from the government and the society, we pay enormous taxes. It's 50% of course, I don't know. So, yeah. Yeah. So now maybe you don't wish to go to Denmark. The economical crisis in the whole world did hit them much. We're dealing with it, but it is difficult. But 50%. Of course, there's a different kind of taxation. If you have low income, it's less. If you have a high income, maybe it goes even above 50%. So it's just, you can earn some money and then pay your business. And of course, people, they find it a little bit difficult sometimes.
This is tax on social security, right?
Yeah.
Not on, you want to buy a computer, you pay 50%.
Oh, yes. Everything is taxed. For instance, cars, they cost half a year salary. And that's because they're taxed. And many of our things, apart from the most necessary things, they have enormous tax. Because they have a secondary tax, it's called IVA, I don't know if you know that tax. It's actually tax upon tax, if you,
If you have your lesson called luxury tax, or Rating Maria, which I believe you have here for cars, which is about like 100%.
And this is 25%. So first you pay your tax, and then you pay your 25% in tax. So there's not much left. And if you look at Denmark, we don't live in enormous houses. We don't have a lot of cars. Many people don't even have because it's too expensive. Yeah. But we deal with it another way, and I'll tell about that later. So it's okay. Let me see here. So something that is interesting about Denmark also is that because of this system, Denmark has actually been rated as one of the happiest countries in the world again and again and again. At the time, it's on a secondary place. But we are keeping our head up, and we stay there. And there's been a lot of research about why are people happy, why what's the factors, and they have come to some specific factors that we can say, okay, that's true for Denmark. Well, first of all, wealth, and we'll say we're not super wealthy, but we have enough. It's okay, yeah. Social equality, absolutely. We need to have social equality. That's it. Trust in the government, yes. We have trust in government. Access to education, yes. All people, they have access to education. Somewhere, of course, you need to perform again, and maybe you can't go into one specific study because at that year they could only allow so many people. But you can go to another. Political freedom, yes. We can talk freely about politics. We can talk about ministers. We can make fun of ministers if we wish. We can go quite a long way. And sometimes maybe it goes a little bit too far, but. We can do it, yeah.
I mean, something, I don't know if it's a role minister, it's bad that the most, the society, the most jokes is on the pension.
They must.
Jokes.
Yeah.
Telling about the pension. How many jokes is on the pension?
It's okay, yeah. And you have cartoons of the Queen, you have cartoons of the ministers, and it's actually in the law that you can do that. Of course, there's something in the law that tells you, okay, you can go that far, you can say that you can be really cruel, but we can go far away. and we can really talk about our people high up without seeing held too responsible for that. It's freedom of speech, and freedom of speech is something that is very important for them. Yep. And of course, yes, that was job security and the good healthcare system. So okay, let's see if we can keep up being the happiest country in the world for a longer time. But something shows that at the moment we might have some problems because we have been overspending in order to keep up this system. But let's see if it is. Okay. So what are they not so happy about? I won't say that this is a fantastic country at all. We have a miserable weather. If you want to have miserable weather all the year round, go to Denmark. We live in darkness half of the year, and
kind of like I have like very long like a winter, you can like stay inside. Can we like change like the mood of that person during the
Yeah, so
life is. Well, we have seen
a lot of
beautiful.
I don't
know. You have like 5 places and you make more fun of.
And you have to like, Well, winter time, when you get up in the morning, it's, you don't have a light yet. People go to work, people go to school.
Spend
months? You're lost. Yeah, well, just out in the darkness. Of course, we have electric light, but don't see the sun.
About the how much? 3 months? 3 months?
No, I would say 4 or 5 months.
It's a long party.
It's a long day. So, in the morning, 9 o'clock, it's still dark, and when you go home, already at 3 o'clock, it's dark again. So we are actually getting quite depressed.
So how are you happiest?
Yeah, exactly. And that's a very, very good question, because what they say in these reports and this research is that they maybe forgot about some factors. And I would say it's a very important factor. I know that during winter time people get so depressed because they know it's just November, it's going to be dark, it's going to be dark until March, and then the light is there, but it's still cold, there's still snow, there's, I just talked with one of my friends the other day, and she said, I'm tired, but and the other day I was thinking, I'm so in springtime and so on, but then the winter is coming so soon back again. So I said, that's a little bit, how it is in winter. Yeah.
So, you could have very long party, you know.
Yeah. I'm saying, summer's so they're beautiful. Because then we have the opposite, that you have the sunshine until evening. But then you can't sleep at night, and then we get problems again, and we get depressed. It's not that bad, but I do exaggerate a little bit about this, but it is actually something that I know about. It is very tough to many people. We need to have clinics, particularly light clinics, where people can go and sit in front of some special tickling lamps for an hour every day, and they are made so that they have got the light of the sunshine. And those it's for people who are really getting stressed. Mm-hmm. So, it helps a little bit, but we can't be coping with it. But, however, there's something else that I would like to talk about, because we do deal with the bad weather in a very particular way. And how do we do that? And now I really need your help, because I have to explain a phenomenon that people say, what is this? Because when we're not really happy, what we can do is to hygge. So we do hygge. And yes, what is Fugue? Would you like to explain what you can do with Android?
Actually, at the beginning, we just was speaking to you about that Fugue. I was having like an abstract idea about it because I think it's unique to the Danish culture. And it's sometimes like I can say it's a party. It's a kind of like a quiet party inside the home. Like the most important like you can have a phone. I think like a wide range of activities, you know, it can be for example living here with friends, but you have like fun, like quiet, or you can also like Christmas time and sit with your relatives and talk and everything. It's a quiet time, but you need to have a fun time indoors. You can say, as a response to the bad weather, they developed a stronger indoor culture where they can have like a quality time with their family and friends. And you can do maybe have them do like very nice food, very nice drinks, or do something like an activity with the relatives and family.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to interrupt. Can we take 5 minutes because we have a guest from CHF and we just want to have a little. You can have coffee if you like. I don't need to interrupt. I'm sorry.
سنعرفكم على السيد وليد طامي هو من CHF اللي هم Global Community هلا Global Community الجديد
جديد
فتفضل تعمل حالك ونقول
صباح الخير يعني شكرا اول شيء على جيسف على انه اتاحوا لنا فرصه نلتقي فيكم الشيء الثاني يعني صار لنا فترة طويلة نحكي بكيف ممكن نتعاون احنا وياهم على هذا البرنامج بس لما تيجي وتشوف الوجوه وكيف هيك عندها حماس كليا يعني بتغير فكرتك عن الموضوع اللي كنت تشوفه على ورق لانك هذا بتشوف في حياة بس حبيك سريعا اتعرف عليكم كل حدا اسمه من وين يعني اي منطقة او عشان اقدر اكون تصور في جروب وايش ممكن يطلع منكم عشان اذا طلع منكم احسن اكون انا توقعاتي اقل من المستوى. عندك
عمير سعيد جبل اسود
اهلا وسهلا.
عمان
صالح
مدبه عمان
محمود القصاص
اهلا وسهلا فيكم. ايش اللي خلاكم تشتركوا بهذا البرنامج يعني؟ ليه؟ بس سمعت عن البرنامج، ليش فكرت تشترك فيه؟
انا مصور وبحاول يعني ارفع قدرات تصوير مجال الميديا والبرنامج.
صور ايش؟ فوتوغراف. فسمعت البرنامج حسيت انه ايش ممكن يرفع قدراته
في مجال ارفع مستويات الميديا في البرودكشن.
طب وين شايف حالك بعد هذا البرنامج؟ وين توصله؟
ممكن يعني برودكشن او مخرج شيء زي
كذا. اوكي.
انا اكشلي درست جرافيك ديزاين بس غيري اكثر الدراما والتلفزيون ما كنتش اقدر يعني بصراحه كنت بواجه مشكله مو شيء خصوصا حسيت انه برضه ما في كثير اكسس اذا بدي اعمل مهنه تمثيل او دراما جنرال سو اي ثينك لما اشتركت مع البرنامج كان اوبورتيونيتي ساعتها مسهله و I think إنه بلش أكون فكرة عن الميديا يعني حسيت حالي I belong و I fit إنه أكون يا مراسلة يا مذيعة حتى حسيت إشي بيكمل مني يعني
أوكي بس بحس إن البرنامج عماله بيساعدك في كل شيء
يور
أوكي
يعني أكثر إشي جذبني للبرنامج إنه في منتورز يكونوا وناس إكسبرتيز بمجال الشغل لأن بالجامعة يعني كانت دكاترة يعني مش كثير متخصصين بالمجال الخاص إنه انفتح جديد الأنيميشن
أعطاني فرصة أنا جرب ديزاينر. أعطاني فرصة إنه أول مرة المهارات التواصل بين الناس والجرافيك ديزاين تكنيك البرامج. وساعد يعني البرنامج بيساعد على اكتشف معارف أكثر قوة السلوك وهذا كان حاجة في اليوروب.
طب فيكم حدا بيشتغل موظف يعني حاليا ولا
لا؟
كل
شعبي
بيستخدم. البرنامج أول شيء يعني عم بعرفنا على ناس أو عم بعرفنا نتواصل مع ناس حتى ما كناش نتوقع نتواصل معهم بس أكيد من خبراتهم. عشان مثلا لما كنا عم بكلمنا البرامج يعني كمان أنا في كرزي هو عم بعطونا أشياء بالفرنسي وعم بدرس فيه تمامًا أساس أنه هو أساس برنامج تعليمي.
أوكي.
صراحة صرنا نحن هذا ثاني أسبوع. من ثاني أسبوع بقدر أحكي لك إنه في هالثلاث أشهر هذول راح نعيش نحن دارسين تعليم بالواقع.
أوكي.
راح كل شيء من الميديا راح يجتمع كله في هالثلاث أشهر.
هو بالمناسبة زوجي بس أضيف على ثلاث شهور هم كل يوم من 8 الصبح للخمس المساء.
أسبوع
للخميس.
ما خلص
أنا أجيب التصوير والإخراج للفيديو فكل الهدف صار لي سنتين بحكي بهذا الموضوع أنا بدي نرفع مستوى الأردن في السينما.
أوكي.
أنا هذا الكومبو بتاعي.
أوكي.
نرفع الأردن بشكل عالمي. أوكي. أكثر شيء بيزنس البرنامج هو التوعية يعني أنا وصلت الصحافة تقريبا من 2009. ومضغطات وهون 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 بس يعني تتدرب على شيء موجود في المجتمع يعني تقدمت للجرائد دستور لكثير جرائد يعني صحيح لي مثلا شغل في جريدة أسبوعية 200 دينار ولا له علاقة بالصحافة طبعا أنا يعني هاي المهنة أنا بحبها وبحترمها لما أروح أصدم في الواقع يعني كان كثير صعب الموضوع في البرنامج يعني مش بس يعني الخبرات اللي بعطيك إياها اللي بتناسب مع السوق برضه يعني تعلمنا على الفلاش مثلا البرنامج الفلاش الاسبوع الماضي كان في شيء اكتشفنا انه في شركه بلشت من مكتب صغير صارت شركه كبيره هي خرابيش قناه رؤيا على سبيل المثال انه كيف كانت قناه صغيره بلشت تكبر من الخبرات اللي انتم بعطونا اياها يعني بنتدرب على شيء احنا بنقدر نلاقي شغل منه مش زي تدريب الجامعه مثلا في الجامعات
النظريه
صحافه واعلام يعني اخذت دوره وكاله بترا كانوا خريجين صحافه واعلام من جامعات كبيره ما بعرفوا يصيغوا تقرير
يعني وبالإضافة إنك تتعلم معارف جديدة عمالك برضو تصير تتعرف على الواقع الحقيقي الموجود بالإندستري وبسوق العمل.
ما
تعلمت
كثير من الكومنت ما كانش في خبراتي.
أوكي.
بس مش إنه عم
نأخذ
ما كان بروز.
أوكي. طيب طب هلا انتم عارفين المراحل اللي حتمشوا فيها بالبرنامج بس تخلصوا من هون رح تروحوا فتره تتدربوا مؤسسات بعدين كل حدا فيكم لازم يدرب مجموعه يكون مسؤول عنها ويوصل جزء من المعارف اللي هو اكتسبها لهدول الناس مشان يحس انه عماله يفيد ناس ثانيين بهاي المعرفه وبعد هيك مين حاب يشتغل الموظف مين حاب يبلش البزنس تبعه اذا في حدا كون هو بكير يمكن هلا كون فكره بس ان جنرال هيك مين صار يفكر بهذا الموضوع ايش تفكروا يو اوف يور اون بزنس ولا
موظف
اوكي
نبلش بزنس
هل يمكنك ان تكون هناك حلو حلو لازم هناك من يمكنك ان تكون هناك الأفلام
يمكنك ان تكون هناك equipment يمكنك ان تكون هناك من trainers but instead they're helping us by donating equipment for our trainers.
طب انترستينج كثير يعني ممتع الحديث معكم وبعدين شايف يعني اذا من اول اسبوعين في طاقه عاده اي ناس تدخل عليهم وتبلش تحكي معهم بدك ورمينج حوالي 5 ل 10 دقائق مشان تبلش تاخذ منه. بس انا قبل ما احكي لكم اسمي بلشت. بالعكس انا مستمتع بها، مش انه يعني هي يعني مديح لكم، مش بليز.
انا عم يكون في كل مرة إشي مختلف، فا يعني إحنا أبديتت على كتير إشي سمعي. رحنا ذاك اليوم على سامسونج، أكيد ما رح نمسك سيارة إحنا حالنا نروح على سامسونج. عم نركز على عم نركز البرنامج على أكثر من موضوع في السيشن. سو هذا إيش بخلينا؟
إحنا كل يوم اثنين عزنا في
الدول
زيارات ميدانية للجهات المختصة بهذا الموضوع.
التوبيك اللي بتكون مدارية.
فبسامسونج شافوا الليتست تكنولوجي بمجال الميديا والتليفونات مستر عام.
سمارت فونز.
لهم سكيول على روبيكم
شيء؟
اه. بعدين انت اخر واحد خلص تعبتون.
البرنامج غير انه عم بعملنا زيارات ميدانية، احنا رافضين انه نروح على حلوى اللي هو عم تحمي الغجرات، هو عم بيعلي انه مش بس عم بعطينا برامج انه ننزل في عشان نعمل جنوبية، لا فقط انه بيفتح ثقافة عن يعني مثلا رحنا على سامسونج، عرفنا اشياء عن سامسونج، احنا مش مستعدين نفتح كمبيوتر وندور جوجل، يعني احنا عرفنا اشياء كثير عن سامسونج، بدل تأسسك كيف بدأ من شيء كثير صغير، يعني هذا عم انه عم بعطينا طموح انه لو بدنا احنا بشيء مثلا في محطة 30 دولار
يميز كثير المهمة في البرنامج ان المتحدثين اللي بحكوا معنا عن الهاند اوت من امريكا يعني شخص مشرك انه موفر لنا شبكه كبيره من الناس يجوا يعني على حسب توقيتهم كل الساعه عندهم خمس دقائق واحد الساعه 4 الصبح
يوم
5 الصبح بس حصلوا معنا استعداد يعني هذول لسه مش شايف قهوه بعطينا في المجالات شغلات كبيرة يعني واحد قاعد من بيت واحد امبارح عن بزنس يعني كان المفروض ساعة امبارح المفروض كان ساعة مدة ساعة ونص معه اللي قبلين مثلا واحد كيف نتعمل الويب سايت تبعك كيف تعمل على الورد بيس يعني شغلات انه حتى في الأردن في سوق العمل أعلى من مستوانا بلد في نفسه.
هلا مين كلكم خريج الجامعة؟
لسه بدرس.
مين خلص جامعة؟ طب انا زي ما قلت محمد اسمي وليد طراونه انا مدير ل عكس which is good يعني لا لانه مع هيك جروب مش عادي لازم تكون عادي انا مدير لمنطقه اسمها global communities اسمنا السابق كان اسمه CHF international احنا international development organization جنسيتها الاصليه امريكيه اشتغل ب 30 بلد في العالم بالاردن موجودين من سنه 98 اشتغلنا بمختلف مجالات التنميه من تطوير مشاريع الصغر المتوسطه من تطوير مجتمعات محليه من مساعده الحكومه على تطوير اطر وانظمه تشريعيه لاستهداف قضايا تنمويه معينه لتطوير مؤسسات المجتمع المدني حاليا بنركز كثير على تطوير المشاريع الصغيرة والمتوسطة. برضو في عنا بروجرام جديد بلشنا فيه هذا الشهر اللي هو اسمه Middle East and North Africa Youth Employment Strategy أو Youth Empowerment Strategy. تحت مظلة هذا البرنامج حيكون تعاون إن شاء الله بينه وبين جسر خلال السنوات القادمة على مبادراتكم وعلى مبادرات ثانية. ان شاء الله يعني حيكون في تواصل اكثر بيننا وبينكم نحاول بقدر الامكان نوظف الموارد المتاحه عندنا لخدمه عقول نيره مثل عقولكم وبتمنى لكم كل التوفيق ان شاء الله واكيد حنتواصل معكم بالمستقبل بشكل اكبر.
شكرا
لكم. شكرا لكم.
Thank you.
اسمع انا ممكن عواز
issues that maybe they don't have in other cultures or something. Like for example, do you know apathy? Like a terrible support, for example?
Yeah.
So for example, think in Arab culture, have like a culture of how to like take care of like the eagles, how to like deal with the eagle things and take care of them and so on. So maybe say, okay, other cultures they deal with it, but they don't have the same like specifics as we do or something. And maybe in American culture has like a chilling out or hang out or something. But it's a book that has special dimensions, like it's more, they have a lot more detail, a lot more personality. And maybe that's good.
Yeah, I was saying many pieces. I said, I'll give some examples. You need examples to understand this completely. So, the Hygge phenomenon is a little bit deeper because we talk about it all the time. It's actually, we can't live without it, and it's there morning. Daytime, evening, whatever, we are always in the middle of doing something critical. And I think people may say that we have learned to do that exactly because of the bad weather and everything. But anyway, we do it when we can. Also, it is very much connected to that we like to do things easily, not too wild, to do it slowly. And I even heard one person explaining it as being something in between fun and sleeping. So not exactly a party time. It's about a psychological way of being. It's not just physical. It's really how to be psychologically happy. Then you are in the middle of people. But you can also use it as describing, I don't know if you said that, describing, for instance, a house. You can say this is a cubicle house. And that means, yeah, again, it's a very good house. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. If you all the time sitting in the house and eating and drinking, becoming used by people?
I'm going to explain to you why we don't become, because we have something else that is very
significant.
We are very healthy. Yes. Indeed, we all understand how healthy.
I think we have in our culture something close to healthy.
Yeah.
I have a relative in West Bank. I was in the cooking and I thought they are we stay in the house for 3-4 days.
Okay.
My other aunt's auntie. Mm-hmm. My aunt is collecting all the children and playing some public games with each other. And the customer in winter is almost. And in winter, we have something like a folklore activity in the house.
Yeah.
Because we are you can't get out of the street or even to buy something from the supermarket. And my auntie, I think, it's because she was studying, she knows how the psychology of the children, we were small children, to not be in the risk from or a week in the house, people could get out. So they create, she created some way to play some colorful games with each other. And with some food traditional, like the soba. The bread with manakish, you know, the cups of
like a classic bread. I think this one's almost like a similar people go into like a book, yeah. Like kind of like a relaxing and people like calm down, like invoking and stuff. But I think this is showing like a really good video about the book. And maybe I can give like maybe one quick example about like one part of the video they have like a laundry place where people like they go outside and they wash their clothes and everything. And in the laundry place there is like a coffee shop. They say people are going to like wash their clothes, but they need to have like a hookah and they need to relax and fun and everything. So they go wash their clothes and they go sitting and they can coffee and tea and stuff. So maybe it's kind of like even the touch of that we as a like a can say like a second like a state of mind and have fun.
Yeah. If you wish to know more about it, there's lots of videos out there, and you can look it up, Google it on YouTube, and you'll find videos describing what it is.
Did you have that again?
Some of the videos. What do you?
Do you?
If I do, will you hear in your? Yes, I do. I'm Danish. Yes.
Yeah.
I do. Yeah. I went to a party the other night and met up with four other Danes, and the party was too loud and too. So what we do? We went back home, and we were sitting at home doing studio because we're used to so much studio. So party became the noisy house. And that's the opposite of freedom. That really a very noisy club. Okay, let me see. Somebody asked about if we were getting fat with all this food. I would ask the same question too if I didn't know about what I'm going to. But we are very healthy culture, and we are also very practical. So one of the things we love to do is to go by bike. And just in Copenhagen, we have 400 kilometers of bike lanes. It's very easy to go along. Actually, some of the bike lanes, they are broader than the streets. And we don't wish to have cars within Copenhagen or capital. We try to reduce it, and we try to have public buses and trains and whatever. And then we try to have some other means of transportation. So actually, 40% of the capital's population commute to and from work with bikes. And we have a special bike, we have cargo bikes, because we need to carry our children to kindergarten, to school, we need to get along. Sometimes we have the whole family sitting in a cargo bike. And I know that I have friends coming from abroad, and they have been looking at this cargo bike. And in the cargo bike, you have maybe that is sitting at the bike. And doing that, then you have two children and a dog, and maybe mother's just behind, sitting. Well, yeah. So we love it. And we find it very cool to go by bike. And we use that picture.
Yeah, and we go back to the basket and everything. So like a state of mind while riding the bike also. It's so good and they're cozy and people like to each other.
So everything is good there, yeah. But okay, there's some other reason to why we go by bike, actually. Because it all started way back in the 70s We had an energy crisis, and also here in Denmark, we couldn't get fuel for heating the houses, we couldn't get fuel for our cars, whatever. So many people decided, okay, skip the car, get a bike instead. And it very much started up also as a change in Denmark, because we need more fuel because it's so cold. So also, so that we're going by bike and skipping the car, our houses become super insulated, super energy high-tech buildings, which is nice because then you don't need to heat them so much. They can maintain the heat in their own way. But also, this phenomenon actually is because we like to have clean energy in Denmark. We want clean energy. We are absolutely wild about clean energy. And to avoid pollution, to avoid global warming. And at the moment, actually, 20% of Denmark's energy is clean, and that is, it comes from either wheels, district heating, bike fuels. Our goal is in 2050 to reach 100% clean energy. So it's quite a goal, but I think it's possible. And with that, we need to construct a lot of windmills. Denmark is one of the countries in the world with the highest windmill production, and we export them. Even though, okay, in China they are going to do the same windmill or wind turbines now, but we still have some quite large exports of windmills. And we have tried for some decades already to figure out how we could do this the best way. Actually, some decades ago, we found out that if people could go and collaborate together, some few houses or whatever, and if they could buy a windmill, they would have tax exemption. That is, no paying taxes if you buy a windmill.
How much is a windmill?
Well, the windmill is quite expensive, it is, but you can do it in groups of people, so there was cooperatives starting to make their own ground, planted a windmill in the middle, and they all had tax exemption and helped for this to become a possibility. However, unfortunately, because of technologically, the windmill at that time, when they started up the project, they weren't that good at creating energy yet. So many of them have closed down today. But they were the beginning of creating the awareness in Denmark of how to really have some good energy for Denmark. And it is a country that all the time tries to think about clean energy, clean energy, clean energy. Copenhagen has become one of the capitals in the world where other people, other countries, they come and visit Copenhagen to see how do you construct these lanes, how do you have public transport, how do you get this and that. And it's all around bikes, bikes, bikes. So I think even in New York now, we've got a bike lane that is called something like Copenhagen. COVID, our system. Any questions?
Do you have background words? Sorry, from background.
Yes. It still exists. We still have the need of using that. But it's every year less and less. Whatever we can do is better. We prefer other kinds of biofuel things, anything that's again clean energy. We still have the old, but we plan to reduce it. There's been also innovation around electrical cars. There's still They're coming, they're coming. They're starting to convey the picture in the streets to you. But they're still a little bit difficult to maintain. But I think they won't come.
Okay. Do you have audio books?
Like audio books? No. We don't have. That was a question, sorry. No, we don't have. Norway is the country with the oil. Norway is what we call the rich Scandinavian country because they got all the oil. Lots of people up there, lots of mountains, lots of unused area there, but they have found a lot of oil, so they are pretty well off. Mm-hmm. But then I know a little bit, but not enough. And we don't want it anyway, so we don't want to be small in that way. I wish to talk about something completely different now to go to another subject to go to. I wish to talk about something about Danish behavior as well. And I would say it's strange behavior, but I'm very used to it, and it's very cultural, a big cultural phenomenon. It's a phenomenon that has been there for, again, I would say, centuries. And it's. And we behave in a way that is that we all need to be equal. Don't be something special. So we have an unwritten law, and it's called the law of Jacob. And all people know about it. Just know what it is. And actually, it's been related to because we are a little bit similar there. And what the unwritten law is saying is that you are not to think that you are anything special. And, well, it goes the happiness again. So how can we be the happiest country where if we don't think we are anything special? But it's something about if you keep everything so individual or so equal, then you need to tell the others, well, we're not something. We have to do something together. We have to do something for the society. We have to do something special. So if one person suddenly says, oh, I wish to become something special. I am something special. I wish to become big, I wish to have a big company, I wish to do this. And the other say, that's not particularly special. Why do you think you're particularly special? And you will hear this attitude. And I won't say it's not all the time, but it's always lurking behind the corner and people start to become individual. The actual law that you say is unwritten, it was created by a Danish writer, actually it's actually back, and he was writing about it, and he was writing a whole book about a small village where all the people tried to keep each other down in this way so that they could come into something special. And he hated it because he wanted to be something special, right? But that's how it is. So we have to be equal.
I think maybe like this one is a bit different, like maybe some past, like in our culture, but can be like maybe you can see it can be constructive a bit. And like maybe it could also be like a collaborative or like build each other and so on. But also can be also destructive in some ways. Like if someone has a tumult or an ambition or something, if you say, oh, okay, you're not special.
Yeah.
Yeah, you look at it. It's like a coin, there are two sides to the coin. If you look in a positive way, it's good. If you look in a negative way, it's good. The problem with our culture is that they did the opposite. Everyone wants to be special. No, really, I think it is. Everyone wants to be special, so no one is going to become special.
Ah.
That's the problem.
Okay, yeah. And it should be balanced.
We should be
equal. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I think maybe it's something also about like how like you said, maybe like some set of rules, and maybe the, like all the rules that follow, you can have like a good system, like good systems, but sometimes you have maybe like a worse several systems. Maybe for example, in the United States, they have like a strong individualism.
follow this. They have like dreams, we suppose, and so on. But then they have like large inequality. But it's maybe in Denmark they have like those people that can be down.
Yeah.
But then here we have everyone wants to be special and then everything else.
They trust their people, they trust their government, they have faith, you know, they have faith in the country, their country. This is something you don't have in the United States, something you don't have here. Something that, even though we say we do, but it's, come on,
seriously. Yeah. Yeah, but it's also a little bit exaggerated. I would say a little bit of the analyst, too much of the respect, as well as. If you have too much individualism, yeah. I prefer the balance. But it's, of course, it's not super general. It is there, and as I told you, people, they become individuals. They start up their maybe own businesses, and they become something special, or become a special artist, a musician, or whatever. It's still possible. But we still have this very informal way to speak to each other. So if I meet, let's say, the Prime Minister, and she's on bike too, on way to work, on her way, because she's like that too, she's on my bike too. So if I meet her, and I wasn't saying, oh, Mr. I'm just saying, I got you.
No, there's no.
Maybe we should take a little bit care of talking to our Queen. But she wouldn't but she wouldn't harm us if we started to be a little informal and say, hi Queen, how are you today? Yeah. Maybe we have to keep a little bit. A little bit. Just as a symbolic
gesture.
Tradition. Oh, yeah, let me see, that was a strange behavior. And I'll talk a little bit about another kind of culture, and that is Hans Christian Andersen, anybody who knows him?
He's a writer of imaginary stories.
Yeah.
Cambridge, Match 7, and Bon Bon. It's a story about the magic garden and the bat. Match, so let's get that.
Yeah, exactly.
They are another stories, I know. He's the father of imaginary stories.
Yeah, he is indeed. I think he is the most famous writer in Denmark and also in the world. He has been translated into 125 languages as well as a writer and also. So he is quite known. He is somebody who liked to also to write stories about human behavior and be a little bit critical and then place it in a fairy tale so that it looked very innocent. But he had his point through. He could really tell a story, so you have to think about what's the something behind. And these stories, fairy tales, they are for children. But they're actually, I think, read more by adults, and so they are as well as adults. Many children, they don't really understand it because there's also so much symbolic meaning in it and so much behind it. But actually, I would like to not tell the whole one of the stories, but just to mention the plot of the story, because again, it's about very typical Hans Christian Andersen's story, and the story goes like that, and maybe you can it's a very egoistic and vain king emperor in a country, and he likes to wear very special clothes, and he likes to show off to his people this fantastic clothes. So what he does is that he hires some tailors to make special clothes. You know, perhaps you know the story, but the story goes like this, that these tailors are actually swindlers. They are swindlers. So they tell the king, to make some clothes for you. It's fantastic. There's just one thing. It's invisible for people who are very stupid and who cannot live up to their position in life. So, after a week, these swindlers or tailors, they come back. They pretend to dress the king, and all the ministers around can't see anything, but they have to pretend before
saying. There
will be exhibits of stupid. So, they dress the king, and the king, he goes for a promenade, he goes out in front of the people. And he walks in front of the people, and all people they say, "Oh, it's beautiful, it's fantastic, oh, it's incredible." Until there's one small boy who doesn't know about this thing that people are stupid, and he's just shouting out, "But he isn't wearing anything." And after that, all people start to listen to the boy because nobody has seen the chosen horse. But the king, he continues, because he is sure that he's the only one who can count, or who can see the end. So, that's a story. But it's a typical Hans Christian Andersen story, and
some of the culture, there are some stories taken from his story, translated, and they think as a popular story.
Yeah.
It's more kid. Very small case, but it's not. I used my mother and my aunts to teach me that exactly. There are also a movie about it, like.
Lots of stories. And I think many of these stories, I know that he actually wrote them from some Spanish folk tales, but he just changed them a little bit around. So they are folk tales that have been around the whole world, so maybe some of them could even come from here.
Some stories, I read a story about birds, singing birds. I read it as a Chinese story. It's called a collection of stories. It's called the Green Bookshop. And they said that this story is a Chinese. So I read it as a Chinese after maybe 20 years when I saw the movie. No, it's a Chinese story.
Lots of stories, and yes, they are international, and some of them maybe it's not a pure danger from being in another way yet. Okay, I don't know. I still have various subjects, but I don't know if there's still something you would like particularly to go about, or talk about, or maybe around some questions about the book, perhaps.
I want to ask about the story of getting the stone.
Yes. It's actually, it goes back to our very first, king in Denmark. And it was around the time of the Vikings. The Vikings had quite a famous role position, and they ruled from 700 to around 1000 or something. And at that time, the first king also started in Denmark, and the Vikings were being quite the cruel invaders, went around pirates, whatever. But they were also good traders, and also good, good communication between, they produced quite a lot. But they were quite wise. So in the different innovations, there was a lot of tendency starting off in Denmark, and that was towards Christianity. And with that time, the first king and the yellow stone became the start of Denmark. Actually, the yellow stone is the first place where you can see the name Denmark written. So it goes back to that time. And I think there was a need for maybe changing a little bit this wider existence of the Vikings. They believed in something completely different. I don't know if you have heard about the Norse gods. Odin. And
worshipping those gods until this day. The National Democratic Front, it's a fascist thing.
Yeah.
They are worshipping the old gods of Norway. Something they was the Viking.
Yeah, but it was a crazy religion. But actually, quite funny to me, it's like mythology today. You had some main gods, as you call them. There was one called Odin, and he was a god of war and actually death and life and everything. And the story about he rode around on an eight-legged horse. So that was what the Vikings believed in at that time. We have one of the others called Thor. And Thor, he was known for thunder and lightning. And every time there was lightning at that time in the air, then people thought that it was Thor riding at his car with two coats, actually, probably. And there was really mythical stories about how he could change into a bird and he could change into. Those gods, they were really exaggerated stories. They're very funny.
The cartoon I saw, not cartoon, a picture, but you know the statue of Jesus in Brazil. It was hit by light. They written Jesus 0, 1.
Yeah.
The Danish cartoon.
Yes.
I have a question about music. What music do you use? How does it work?
Denmark has got quite a vivid music life. We've got lots of festivals, and we've got also quite a lot of singers, also worldwide. Something that Copenhagen is very popular known for is jazz music.
Really?
Yeah, it's been for many years. Probably jazz musicians, and every summer for I don't know how many decades, we have 1 week of jazz music and jazz musicians. So we got quite a lot of places where the open concerts, even if it's raining, with our umbrella and our hygge, and we do the hygge under the umbrella while we watch the concert. So, quite a
lot. Another question about the music. What is the national instrument?
The anthem is.
Instrument. Yes.
I mean, the national instrument. I think we are a little bit into everything, but if you think about jazz, then you know the instrument the best. Mm-hmm. So maybe it's that. I don't know, we really have a particular instrument that is into us. Maybe piano also, because that is also jazz. So maybe those two instruments would be some of the more known instruments. But people love to play music. And when they do good, they play music. Because we have this educational system, we have also a lot of education too, and then play a music instrument and whatever. So it's very normal that in some way they attend some groups of music to make their own band, whatever. And some of them are terrible, and others are fantastic. So. But yeah, very vivid vision of this. Traditional food, yeah. Well, traditional food. Food, we still have traditional food, but it has changed over the last decade. And I think it's
the most popular.
Yeah, the most popular. If you go and do it, yeah, of course, I'm a bit ashamed to tell so, but it's pork meat. Yeah, with potatoes and sauce, and that is a traditional meal. Because Denmark really a bit different from here, and one of our biggest production is actually pork meat. We have more pigs in Denmark than actually people.
The canned meat of pork, it's a Danish joke.
Which one?
You say
the canned was in Jordan.
The local
that are buying. The cheese and all these things. Pork apple cheese, you put this.
Pork and the ham and shoulder meat. It's a Danish
Yeah. But
I eat some Danish food. Okay, you have some flakes that the brown bread and fish, and you have a soup on the bread.
Yeah. That's another one. But something that is typical is also the open sandwich. For some reason, we have developed sandwich without something on top, and makes the foreigners quite crazy when they have to go into it. They have to eat it like a sandwich. Open sandwiches are very normal. All kinds of things on top and whatever. So we have a really rich kind of sandwich there. Yeah, the room is smart because it's difficult to eat. We need to have a fork and a knife. Yeah, we sit and eat it. Yeah, maybe like a pizza, we try, but you should do it.
I didn't know it was a
pizza. Usually, what I'm doing is potato and the sauce.
Yeah,
very good. The secret is
No, that's not healthy, but that's why I started off telling you that we are not so traditional any longer. It may be traditional at Christmas time. That would be the time where we eat it in a special way, we have the sauce.
Just for Christmas?
Yeah, because Denmark is a very multicultural society today. So if you look at restaurants in Copenhagen, it's their time, they're Greek, they're from Northern Africa, they're from the whole world, I would say. But you can find maybe one little restaurant in the outskirts of Copenhagen with traditional Danish food. It is said that we have maybe something traditional coming back now, and that is to eat porridge. Porridge, you know.
Sometimes I can be some bread, but normally just cereal.
Yeah.
What's the ingredients there?
Okay, we have various days of government that we are celebrating. We have the 5th of June, that is a day back from 1849, that was when we created the Danish law as it is today. Apart from it's changed in 1953.
I read somewhere that Marguerite the First, she stopped the war and changed the constitution. And still right now, the same.
The constitution goes back to 1849, so it's not at that time. It's,
she changed some rules. She stopped the war.
But it's not. It has changed so many times since then. Yeah. So it's not really that day.
Do you think actually there are some programs in Algeria about the story of the flag? Story of this is the mention there a lot of federation with Norway and Sweden. Have a lot of federation with those countries.
Yes, it goes back actually. Denmark and Norway and Sweden, they were together in one big union when we go back in history. And actually, Norway and Denmark remained for quite a long time until only 150 centuries back. Whereas Sweden, they broke out already in 1500 and something. But they remained, so the whole Scandinavian area was actually together. So Denmark used to be much bigger, but it did kind of came smaller and smaller and smaller. You also had the borders, or we have the borders to Germany, and these borders, they have been moving up and down until Germany unfortunately took a very big piece of it. So yes, we were quite big. We also
have a funny flag, you know, all the flags of this community,
a
lot of colors. Blue, yellow, white, red, everything.
Back to there's the 11th rule that came up from the novel. There's another rule that came up out of another 11th.
Yeah, there's 11 rules actually, from this novel,
You not to think that there are a few things to talk about today?
You're not to think that?
That there aren't a few things to talk about.
Let me see.
How I just say that there aren't
a few things. Actually, I got with me, so let me see it. There says you're not to think that you are anything special, and then there's you're not to think that you are as good as us.
Yeah, but there's
the 11th one. You're not to think that there aren't a few things we know about you. That's a little bit crazy, this one. I admit, that's just to say that don't feel safe. We know if you try to be something special. So we know if you start to get an interview, we already know.
Because we have to be.
So that's the meaning of it. It's cruel, isn't it? Yeah.
Then Musk gets back to life, he said that was talking about.
I
don't know if people have their personal goals or something, can be also negative. I think maybe, it's like good things and bad things.
That's killing the medium, by the way. I think this that slow it's killing the people.
Yeah.
Yeah, but also kills the ambition too.
It's not necessarily for the general benefit of good.
Okay, ambition
of the hand.
Okay.
الجشع
لان الطموح
كمان
لان
الطموح
بيقتل الجشع عشان المصلحه العامه عشان
المصلحه
العامه
Well, the British point, we have lots of castles, and they're still there. We've got some Viking fundaments. We don't have the castles any longer, but there's some stones there.
Back from?
Yeah. Back from the Viking times, the 700 but when people, when tourists come to visit Denmark, we got a statue to show them. And it's very funny, it's a little moment that's actually from one of Hans Christian Andersen's fairy tales. And it's a statue, this statue, not here. And it's sitting on a stone in the harbor. So when people come to Denmark and they're told they're going to see number one tourist attraction, but they got the castle there. They're too big for us. We like small tourists. So we show this statue, and they have come all the way from Japan or China, whatever, and they say, look at this little statue. It's a very nice little statue, but it's called the Little Mermaid, and that's actually what it's symbol of. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You are checking our Puri, the Puri is a little
more. It is, yeah. I think he had Disney a lot.
He had Disney a lot, yeah. Good business.
Disney away,
Actually, I want like your comment about Disney. Like, it's like a quick note. If maybe you're just in journalism and history of the media, like, you know, now like we see like Hollywood and the United States with like very good like movies and everything. But actually, in the 20s, 30s, 40s, and 50s, a lot of like people from Denmark, Sweden, they immigrated to the United States because it was like more like opportunities and so on.
Yeah.
But a lot of the movies, obviously, like Disney and so on, were like a result of like the Scandinavian interactions.
Yeah.
So, you can do
like
more history of the cinema, and
you
see a lot of like Danish and
the Swedish. They have a lot of great imagination from the Danish writers. Because they are all the time, I think, all the time in the Olympics. So they get stories from their imagination. Because they have pain and dark inside.
Yeah, when you said that,
they create a good world from their imagination and not their own stories.
Yeah, that's true. And actually, it's true that there have been quite a lot of films and now some international movies who won prizes. But we have also had some good, very good television series now that also they're going abroad and actually they've become famous now. We even have one television series that we saw that would never go abroad. Very famous, and it tells about the political system in Denmark. But somehow people have, they like it. So that is then we have a Krimi series that is called The Killings, and we have also lately moved around the world. So yes, Google it.
That's leading to another question. What is the level of the crime?
Unfortunately, it has become a bit bigger, or it has increased in the last decade. But in general, it's so that we don't expect anything really bad to happen. Murders, no, we don't have. It happens, yes, it happens, but it's rare. Thieves, simple thieves, whatever it is that happens. Yeah, something small, yeah. Big crime, corruption, and such, no, not like that. But of course it does exist. It does exist. Mm-hmm.
for you to just have to say hi, how are you, and then it's very, very simple. We say hi. Sorry, no. Actually, the Danish language is getting so influenced by English now. So I would say that maybe 50% of the words, more or less, English. So,
but say how are you?
But then how to be? What?
For you? Yeah. It's for us.
Okay, that's right. Okay. What then is how? What then?
What then?
What then? How? To? Say. And literally, it's translated as how you have got it. So we change a little bit around. What then? How to be? When we are also very important, so we say sometimes, or we just ask, are you okay? And you understand that, are you okay? Mm-hmm. So you would be able to pick up a few phrases and sentences in Denmark, particularly when you're around young people, because they tend to speak half English.
So what's the literary translation?
What then how? What then is how? And how, that's the verb to have. And do, that is you. And de, that is it. So how have you it, actually, that's literally.
I'll ask you a simple question, maybe you can think about it. Do you have insurance and bikes, like cars?
Insurance? Yes, lots of insurance, yes.
On the car?
On the car,
the insurance has. For the accident or something? Yes. Or the CA in Germany?
Yes, yes.
For what? Insurance? Really?
Yes.
For what? Try to get on the internet, there's lots to find. I'm looking at the nature of the earth.
A clean body, we have a clean body, yes.
I think that all the people have that social problem.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's just like, we need to tell them from the clean body of the organization.
You need to recharge that.
No, we need the yellow because we have a
headset.
Would you like a sandwich?
You guys are so surprised that we haven't been doing this. We're not speaking.
Oh my god.
I'm going to go to the next one.